Ever feel something you just knew in your gut was 100% right, but everybody told you different? And then in the end, they turned out to be wrong and you ended up saying, I knew it, I knew it, I knew it. Why didn't I listen to my intuition? Well, I have this great story. It's in two parts of how you can learn to trust your intuition and how you can back up your inner knowing with a sign from the universe. Now, since I'm extremely intuitive, I'm not going to give you a personal story about me because you'll be like, well, Colette, easy for you to say. Your intuition is like Olympic gold medal type intuition, which would be true. So instead, I'm going to use a person I know who has never claimed to be an intuitive, and his name is Mark. Now, I think my husband Mark has one of the best stories about how if only he had listened to his intuition, he could have been a huge rock star. Honestly, though, I'm personally glad he didn't, or I might not have known him. Now, this story is a little long, but I swear it's worth it, and it plays out like a movie. Okay, so like me, my husband always wanted to be a professional musician, and he worked really, really hard to get there. And finally, at 26 years old, which, by the way, was somewhat on the older side of getting a deal back then, he and his band handed their demo tape to a local manager. But not before they had sent that same demo tape out to dozens of companies all over the world and spent months and months waiting on a reply. Usually, all they got was a rejection letter coming back their way, if they heard anything back at all. Now, Mark had been sending out demo tapes since he was like 19 and had never gotten anything but one slight interest back when he was 21, which then fizzled out and that band broke up. With his new band, they got to work recording demos and finally felt that they had some really strong material on their hands, but nobody was biting. So he and his band finally decided that enough was enough. Enough. They would just shop it locally. And that's why they ended up putting it in the hands of a local management company in Toronto. They heard back from the management company saying they loved the songs. And by the way, he just played them for me the other day. They are so good. Anyhow, they wanted to set up a meeting to see them live. The manager ended up loving them. He told them he had just formed a brand new record label and the band would be their very first band on that label. And the manager quickly introduced Mark's band to his new partners. The band was swiftly picked up by one of the partners in a limo and they drove to this meeting. The partner told the band how they would do this and that for them, basically promising them that they would be treated like royalty. Oh my gosh, it all sounded so great to the band. They were excited and feeling like they were finally catching a break. But Mark had a really bad feeling about this guy. His gut, what men usually refer to as intuition, just didn't sit right. And red flags were going off for him left, right, and center. So they arrive at the meeting, which was held at a fancy schmancy restaurant, and everything was like a big banquet. Now these guys, they all came from blue-collar working-class families, so they were quickly charmed and taken over with the grandeur of it all. And the label partners were all there, wining and dining them, making them feel like this would be an everyday experience. So everything on the outside looked like a musician's dream come true. Like a Brinks truck had just backed up to their houses and they were going to unload huge bags of gold from it. But again, Mark didn't like them. Something just felt off to him. But his bandmates were so excited and kept telling him to not be so negative. You know, Mark couldn't put his finger on it, but his gut check still told him this was going to be too good to be true. And it was. Okay, so then the partners quickly got a contract in front of them and the band went to the top lawyer in the Toronto music business. And that lawyer said, "Whoa, this contract is a mess." The band informed the partners and within one day, those partners had swooped in and hired those lawyers right from under the band. Mark was so pissed and intuitively felt this was a really bad omen. His intuition was on hyper alert. He just didn't know how to read the signs. But their supposed new manager, who had actually a conflict of interest by also being a partner of the new record label, introduced him to another well-known lawyer. But in the meantime, the label had already booked studio time and the band had been rehearsing for weeks to go into the studio. They got their meeting with the new lawyer and he sat them down and gave them the facts of life as to how many bands actually ever got to where Mark and his bandmates had gotten to. And even though this was a terrible contract that would lock them into 5 albums, he didn't think they'd ever get another opportunity. At 26, they were aging out. Okay, so the band started recording. But Mark was still a holdout. He would not sign that contract. Actually, he refused to sign it, knowing there was something totally fishy about it. And if they only held out, they at the very least could get a better deal. And at best, someone could still enter their lives to sign them to something much better. But he was so pressured by the band, the label, and their conflict of interest manager. Mark was under so much pressure now that if he refused to sign, they would move on without him. They were going to kick him out, even though he was a co-founder of the band. His intuition was a 5-alarm fire, but the outside pressure was too much, so he relented and he signed the contract. Here's the part of the story that breaks my heart every time. An A&R guy from one of the biggest record labels in the world, Atlantic Records, personally called Mark 2 weeks after he signed that deal and said they loved the band and they wanted to know more. Mark explained they had just signed and the A&R guy from Atlantic, Derek was actually his name, he said he couldn't believe it. We just got to your tape and you've signed with somebody else already? With who? Mark's heart sank. If only he had listened to his intuition, but it didn't end there. So if that wasn't bad enough, they started getting more and more letters of interest from other labels around the world. And for once, these weren't rejection letters, but letters wanting to set up meetings. One by one, they came in until there were 6 offers. So Mark took it to the band's small label and said, hey, these guys all want us. Why don't you sell our contract or do a worldwide distribution deal with them? And the label said, sure, sounded great. And Mark said he wanted to be in on the meetings. And they said they'd think about it. Now, in the meantime, Derek from Atlantic Records New York City flew to Toronto to hear the band live for himself, and then he went back to New York with the recommendation that they do some kind of a deal with the band's small Toronto label. So the band's small label left on a whirlwind tour to meet with a bunch of labels in New York that had shown interest, but without Mark and without the band. Again, Mark's intuition was so loud, there was definitely something off. So months went by, nothing ever came of those meetings. The band went on tour across Canada. They actually had a #1 hit song on the radio in Canada, but without the tour support money, they couldn't back it up. And they got several more songs on the charts, but could only muster local support. I love their music, actually. Anyway, then their manager sold his share of the label to the other 2 guys and got out, and as a result, wanted nothing more to do with the label or the band. It was a royal shit show. Mark got so fed up with it all, and the band stopped being a band. So fast forward years later, Mark was in New York, and like it was a serendipitous moment in time, he bumped into the A&R guy, Derek, from Atlantic Records. And it was Derek who recognized Mark and called him by name. So they got to talking, and he explained why Atlantic never followed up. He said that had the band been in the meeting, the president of Atlantic Records would have been able to see past the 3 partners of the Toronto label. He said that talking to them was like talking to the 3 Stooges. So rather than deal with them, they made an offer to buy the band's contract and take over the band. And it was apparently a phenomenal offer. But the label partners wanted to keep their hooks in the band. They wanted to be part of the deal as a small label on Atlantic Records, as a sub-label. And, well, the rest is history. The president of Atlantic Records wanted nothing to do with them. And he had a saying, bands are like buses. Another one comes along every 10 minutes. So they passed. And Mark had never heard why up until that moment. And to this day, Mark can recall the exact moment, like it was clear as day, in the limo ride to meet the small label partners. His intuition was screaming, get out of the car and go home. Now, he loves his life today. After all, he did marry me, and he's my rock star. But if he can say he only has one regret in life, it's that one moment in time he can clearly point to, a time he didn't listen to his intuition, and how years later, it absolutely broke his heart knowing the full story. But lucky for me, he does laugh it off, saying if it wasn't for that moment, we might never have met, and that would have been the real tragedy. Yeah, he's a bit of a sweet talker. But that takes us to the second part, or the twist in the story. If you feel a strong intuitive hit, how do you confirm it, right? After all, intuition can begin as a gut feeling, but it's more than just a gut feeling. It's both deeper and wider than just the internal nudges you feel that guide you toward or away from something. Your intuition is kind of like a radio, a tool you can tune to pick up on the many signs, feelings, and factors that come together to give you guidance and direction from the universe. Sometimes intuition tries to guide us away from something that isn't right for us, like a bad record deal. Sometimes it guides us towards something that's meant for us, even when it isn't the thing we desire or that our logical minds tell us is best. One of the big questions I'm always asked is, how can I learn to trust my intuition? And that's when I tell people my dragonfly story. My husband Mark and I had an experience like this when we were looking for a home in Connecticut years ago. This is a story about how you can confirm the nudges or gut feelings you get with clear signs from the universe. Okay, so we'd been staying in a shitty small hotel room looking for days on end for a new place to live. We saw house after house, and every single one seemed wrong. Before long, we had exhausted all of the available options, and we were pretty grumpy about the whole thing. We kept telling ourselves that if this was going to be the right house, there would be a sign. Specifically, we asked the universe to show us a dragonfly if the home was the right one. Now, dragonflies had long been a symbol of good fortune and specifically protection for me in many aspects of my life. And I was sure, especially if I asked, that if I saw one, I would know that it was the right place. Although we had not loved a single home we looked at, and there had been no clear signs, I had this strange intuition that we should go back and see this one house one more time. And Mark did not agree. Oh my gosh, he hated it. He didn't like the house and felt there was no reason we should waste our time. But he agreed nonetheless, and we met up with the realtor one more time to see this place. When we arrived, we found that in the days since we had first seen the house, it had been staged with new furniture and decor. So while I chatted out front with the realtor, Mark went inside to wander around. Now, as she and I chatted, I came to find out that the realtor and I had a bunch of mutual friends. It was the weirdest coincidence that kept us chatting for several minutes. I found myself wondering what had led us back to the house that day and what the meaning in this connection with this woman could be. Oh, just then, I saw what looked like a child's toy helicopter, or maybe a teeny tiny drone flying above me. So I squinted my eyes to try and see what it was, and I swear to God, it turned out to be this humongous giant dragonfly. I screamed, freaking out the realtor, and I ran inside shouting for Mark. And at the same moment, I heard him calling my name. You should have seen the dragonfly. It was this big, I blurted out. And just as Mark explained that inside, he had found two little matching frames with images of dragonflies as part of the new decor. Now, although the house had not been our original pick, we knew we had to trust the signs. So we moved into the house and we lived there happily for several months. We always knew the home was temporary, but we weren't sure where we would end up next. One day, I received a call from a girlfriend back in Canada telling me she had a house that we would absolutely love. I know you're not looking to move back to Canada, but this place is so perfect, she said. So we set up a tour via Skype. On our virtual tour, I've got to be honest, I was blown away by the house. And we weren't planning to move back to Canada, but we decided anyway to fly up for a weekend to see this place in person. As we walked through the house, we were amazed. There were dragonflies everywhere. I mean, not real live dragonflies, little keyhook center dragonfly details. It was freaky. And we recognized the sign immediately, but we were still torn. The dollar had recently dropped and the price was still pretty good, but it was still at the high end of our budget. So if we decided to move here, we might be setting ourselves up to be house poor. So we had a decision to make. We decided we would trust the signs. So we decided to trust that the guidance of the universe had never led us in the wrong direction, and that was true. And after all, we did want the house. So we put faith in the idea that if we said yes to the house, good things would come. And come they did. So we moved in the early summer, and on one of our first evenings in our new home, we sat out on the back porch admiring the beauty and the chain of events that had taken us to this little spot. I was about to go inside, though, because there were a lot of mosquitoes gathering around us. And suddenly, a flock of over a dozen dragonflies came flying overhead, and boy, did those mosquitoes disappear quick. We laughed our heads off. We were definitely being taken care of. You know, at this point, we didn't even need the sign, but it felt as if they were welcoming us, like a confirmation for following our intuition and the signs the universe gave us to back up our inner nudges along the way. And that house ended up being an incredible place for us, where good things have flowed easily our way. And that's the way intuition works. It can start as that inner gut feeling we so often hear about, but it's so much more than just that. The sixth energy is about understanding that your intuition is your guidance system as a whole. It's your connection to spirit, to the universe, your perceptiveness about the signs the universe sends your way. It's the process of trusting your inner knowing and the way it ties together your experiences, perceptions, and feelings to guide you. Energy six is also known as the third eye energy of intuition. It's about clarity and trusting your intuition without letting your mind throw you off by what you know and feel to be true. This is all about trusting in what you cannot see and trusting what the five senses can't show you. It's a special kind of knowing. Intuition is your primary skill set. It's time to trust it more and bring it into balance with your intellect. And this energy, well, it's about your intuition and your heightened sensitivities. You could say the sixth energy is your sixth sense. When the sixth energy is out of balance, you could become overwhelmed, your imagination becomes fixated on negative stories and trying to predict potential outcomes that could lead to more challenges. You may also tend to feel uninspired or apathetic. You may mix up your intuition with your survival instinct and start to believe that trouble is lurking in every corner, or you could become an escapist and drink or drug too much. Now, I know there are some of you that would love to dive deeper into this and other energies, and that's why, with your permission, I invite you to visit my playlist of all the other energies that comprise the seven main stories that make up your life experience, and how, by knowing which energies need a little extra attention, you get closer to living your life free of outside influences and living your true, authentic, and inspired life. So look for the links here that will take you to that playlist, and then we'll also give you more resources to explore these energy themes further.